But in any case, one final point about the person who said, well, we've got to distinguish between things that you can't change, like I can't change the fact that I'm 1/8 black and maybe they'll find out, but it's up to me whether or not I'm gay or not. As I said to people at dinner last night, I was largely brought up by my lesbian aunt, and she suffered an enormous amount of pain in her life, largely because of the inability of the stupid little community we lived in to even begin to comprehend who she was, what she wanted, how she wanted to live, how she wanted to love. And the rejection of those people, to be told, you can't belong, even to the limited extent of cutting the grass or delivering the service. We wouldn't for a moment tolerate that anymore if somebody's renting out an apartment building and say, we don't want any gay people here. We're not going to permit that. We're not going to let those people be hurt in that way. We don't believe they chose this in order to piss off God or something. In most cases, they were born that way. I welcome trimming back the inclination of faith groups to discriminate against people on the basis of the exclusivity of their beliefs and their right to, within their own congregation, to talk about them and believe in them and so on, and to discriminate against those people in forms of employment that really don't have anything at all to do with their liturgy or their sacraments.
Yeah, there's comments from other panels. I could
out of
time.
I'm actually really sorry to hear that because obviously I do think that there should be a way in which illiberal religionists still affirm a liberal polity, right? It's not inconsistent. I think there's a passage in the Old Testament where the Jews were in exile, right? They went to Babylon. And I think in that passage it says something about pray for the city that you find yourself under and work for its peace.
Jeremiah 29.
Okay, so thank you. Sure. So I don't see why you cannot have a sense that we are better as a religious group to live in a liberal polity where liberalism is a way of organizing society in a pluralistic way, where we have a way of having a democracy that establishes the base level of what we all have to abide by. And we can all live in peace with each other, believing radically and incommensurate different things, and respect each other. Because our illiberalism should be confined to our own community. We're not trying to force that on you. We're not trying to say that you should act this way when you're not in your private sphere. But in the public sphere, we are a multiplicity of cultures, a multicultural group, and we want to recognize and affirm our multicultural and pluralistic society and welcome everybody to speak. And the real issue is to try and draw the line as to jurisdictions. That is, liberalism, secular liberalism, wants to have it all the way down. Secular liberalism is itself a religion. Law has its own religion, which radically conflicts with our religion in some groups. Okay? It's a cultural, and that religion is something that wants to go all the way down and govern all of society in a comprehensive way, rather than leaving some areas of sovereignty for groups to live by their own norms. So long as people are free to exit from the norms, and so long as there isn't some imposition of those norms on people who are not part of the group. Before getting to your point, I just want to make one point, and that is that all I'm saying is that there's all kinds of rooms for you to criticize groups, okay? If you got your penis cut when you were a child, you should go back to your group and say what it cost you and why you disagree with that. You should have voice, okay? But if you can't get your group to agree with you, then the option is to form your own group. Don't do it to your children. Rather than saying that as by force of law, we're going to force that group to stop male circumcision.
Thank you.
as liberal.
All right, I'll try to very briefly address questions 1, 2, 3. Starting with 3. The questioner indicated that consent was just not good enough when it came to barbaric practices, and I would totally agree with that. What the questioner and I would probably disagree about is what is a barbaric practice, because it's the word barbaric that is doing all the work. So we need to have more discussions about harm and where we would draw the line. The first and third questions, the lack of inconsistency between freedom and equality. Of course, once we stop talking about formal equality and we're wanting to treat everybody the same, once we start getting into the much more difficult substantive equality, then there is less inconsistency, although I think at bottom, when it comes to the crunch in some tough situation, you will have to choose either freedom or equality. But the other important thing, I think, to keep in mind, some of us are offering examples of individual member versus their own group, that type of conflict, and others of us are offering examples of religious group versus state. And the same considerations and the same rules do not necessarily apply to both types of conflict, and I think we need to bear that in mind in discussing things.
And just one very last final point. When we are thinking about individual versus identity group conflicts, and this is often where the issue of women's equality comes up in the examples that people have been using, I do think we need to also be careful about distinguishing clearly between the public sphere and the private sphere, because it's arguments about the private sphere that have allowed practices of violence against women and other vulnerable individual group members to take place in the past. So simply because something is happening in the private sphere, I don't think we can necessarily say that there shouldn't be any state scrutiny, nor do I think it's necessarily sufficient to say that there's an exit, a possibility of exit or a right to exit or freedom to exit. Exit may not be a viable choice for people because of social and economic reasons, dependency reasons, and so on. So again, I don't think we can make assumptions about, you know, public versus private, harm versus no harm. These are things that we have to talk about in the context of individual cases. And I think that's exactly what we're going to do in this last session.